You think?
Yeah.
Do you know there are specific sounds of the 80s that only Gen Xers recognize?
Oh, sure. I mean, you know, you got the sound of the clank of the rotary phone. Somebody hangs up, slams down on it.
Yeah, right.
Like, I hate your guts, Leroy. Bam!
But yeah, kind of. I mean, more like, you know, like sounds like this.
Bueller. Bueller.
So I got to thinking, maybe we should do like 80s songs that remind you of 80s movies.
So you mean to tell me we're playing songs that remind us of a movie?
That was in the 80s.
Sounds good.
So I say movie songs that remind us of 80s movies?
Right after this.
Here's the deal. On YouTube, they hate the fact that you use anything that's copyrighted. And every person out there wants to make sure they cash in on you when you create these videos. So this video literally is gonna make us zero money even if we were monetized.
It's called demonetizing.
So we're doing this because we love
the 80s.
And we really want to just do this
and
episode.
We're gonna take you down the nostalgia road.
So to help us out, please be sure to like, share, and
subscribe, and don't forget to ding his
dong,
because that's the only way you're gonna know when we upload new videos.
And it helps us when we're getting demonetized for videos.
Because hey, it's all about you, our peeps.
Entertaining you.
Not saying that you're a really marshmallow Easter candy thing, but
you know, it allows us to keep drinking whiskey.
Yeah, that's right. Oh, welcome to Whiskey Pop. I'm Zane.
And I'm Jeff.
And guess what? Today we're going to drink some whiskey.
We are. And we're also going to talk about 80s songs that remind us of 80s movies.
You know, we're going to do that too.
But let's start with the whiskey first.
It's because it's what binds us.
Holds us together.
Together.
Makes us one. So today we're going to have Foolproof 1792.
Now tell us about the time we reviewed 1792.
That was way, way back. Like
that's
back
right.
Almost 1792.
That was a long time ago.
And I remember being like, eh. But I hear the foolproof is the bee's knees.
Wow.
Okay, it's awesome. Totally tubular.
Yeah, hey, that works.
Pop this
open. That's so fly right now.
Ready?
So
what do you think? We should partake? We should. We shall. I say we should drink this. What do you think?
I think we shall.
You know, I'm kind of excited about maybe reviewing this on
second pour,
which is on
Friday.
But in the meantime,
so the 80s.
If we're gonna talk about 80s music that reminds us of an 80 movie.
Yeah, we have to lay some ground rules, right?
We gotta lay some ground rules here. You just can't like throw out like, I don't know, let's say it can't have the movie title in it. I mean, so you can't play Ghostbusters.
Who you gonna call?
Ghostbusters!
Who you gonna call?
You can't pick songs that actually have the movie's lines in it, because that makes no sense. Because yeah. Of course it's gonna remind you of the movie. All right, so our song. So here's how we're gonna do it. We're gonna play the song. We're gonna give you a few seconds to recognize maybe what movie that song is.
Yes.
And then we're gonna show you clips from that movie that relates to that song. And then we're gonna talk about that movie and the song.
Yeah, all right, let's do it.
All right, so our first one
is
Bourbon.
again, I'll shoot you myself.
Okay, so Axel F. and Beverly Hills Cop, I mean.
That
seems like a gimme, right? So when Beverly Hills Cop came out, I mean, it's just, that set the tone for, I mean, basically Eddie Murphy for me.
Yeah, it's the edgy, I'm not going to say raunchy, that's not the right word.
But it wasn't raunchy, right?
Yeah, it's just, but it's that on the cusp of like what socially is accepted, especially on like movies, TV.
I mean, with Axel F., it's like, it always thought was funny was like how his relationship was with his superior.
Inspector T, how you doing? Where the fuck you been, Foley?
Okay, so this next one, if you don't remember what movie this goes to, we'll be shocked. Because you clearly weren't born in the 80s if you have a problem with this one.
Top Gun, dude. I mean, we were still like in the Cold War era.
Oh, for sure.
I mean, I would say this much. I bet there were a lot of naval aviators that went into the service because of Top Gun.
Oh, I think there's a ton of people who were inspired.
Or even the Air Force.
Between
itself.
The fact that G.I. Joe built, you know, planes that looked like movies from the Top Gun.
Yeah.
And you played with them, and then you saw the Top Gun movie, and you wanted to be You didn't want to be Goose, because Goose bit it.
F-14, spoiler alert. F-14 Tomcat is like one of the most beautiful
badass machines ever.
It's amazing.
I would hop in, and I hate flying.
I ain't going to no airport, Hannibal.
All right, so this next one.
Like a knight in shining armor. From a long time ago. Peter Cetera.
He almost is the runner up to the king of 80s movies.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Kenny Loggins would be still number one.
Peter Cetera, actually, his voice is synonymous within that era. I mean, for sure.
And that's Karate Kid too.
Yeah.
I mean, so I don't remember there being a song that specified Karate Kid.
No,
that song clarified Karate Kid as a thing, a pop culture icon,
Oh, sure.
Yeah, I mean, who didn't want to go to Okinawa with
Miyagi
after that?
Oh, man.
Did you ever try to actually chop the ice?
No, this is a good example of where, like, the total package of what a movie was about had to be there for it to have the effect, because without that song...
It would have just kind of fell flat, right?
It would have been flat within that moment.
I mean, this song doesn't sound Japanese at all. Okay, so this next song proves that Kenny Loggins still is the king of 80s movie music. How does this not give you feelings of Chevy Chase and golfing and a gopher dancing? Look.
Caddyshack is a classic.
Absolutely.
And the thing is, it was like, that was almost before my time. It was so
1980.
Old. Yeah, it was like.
But it's been around for so long.
I mean, you know, I was a 3 or 4.
The Magnificent Seven's beyond our time too, but that doesn't mean it's not in a beautiful movie. Good and the Bad and the Ugly is a beautiful movie. It was before our time.
But what I'm getting at is it's still the quintessential.
Is there any golf movie that even comes close to this movie?
Yeah, Tin Cup.
I knew you were going to throw Tin Cup, Kevin Costner.
Costner's
I knew you were going to throw that out.
Don, Mother Lovin'
Johnson.
You
know there was the Legend of Bagger Vance. You didn't throw that out there.
No, because Tin Cup.
Other than Tin Cup, Caddyshack is the king
absolutely.
Of golf movies, right?
Absolutely.
So this is Chevy Chase and Bill Murray. Dan Aykroyd was in the second movie, actually.
Yeah, maybe.
I mean, he was.
If I pull the arrow out, will you please suck out the poison for me?
I'm gonna prove it right now that Kenny Loggins is the king of 80s movies. Meet me halfway. Okay, so would you consider this an obscure movie?
I don't know. I've seen it so many times, it was never obscure to me.
And it's a B movie. It was a box office failure, if I remember right.
Now, I don't know about that because I was a VHS king during this time.
And now, I mean, think about it. I mean, this definitely was not Stallone's strongest movie, but we remember it a lot.
I mean,
it's about arm wrestling.
It was so great. And let me tell you what, we arm wrestle.
I mean, think about it. Remember when we first started Whiskey Pop, we were doing arm wrestling?
Oh, yeah.
We did that because of that damn movie.
Yeah. What we're talking about is Over the Top.
Over the Top. That movie is.
Over the Top.
Over the Top. It's just a bad movie.
I mean, it's like he's got his hat on, but when he turns around backward, he becomes the machine. And then it's like, you know, and then it's like the secret move. Over the thumb.
Do you ever notice that guys that actually really, truly arm wrestle, that their arm is like freaking ginormous on one side, and it's like this, it's like, y'all might want to switch hands once in a while. Daylight come
stack banana till the morning come.
Daylight come
Come, Mr. Tallyman, tally me banana.
Daylight come and me one go home.
Come, Mr. Tallyman, tally me banana.
Daylight come and me one go home.
Flip
6 foot, 7 foot, 8 foot, bunch.
Okay, so I can't hear this song and not think about Beetlejuice.
Beetlejuice.
It's impossible.
The song was popular. Like 40 years before.
40 years before Beetlejuice.
But
like,
come
more
on.
Like 30 years before Beetlejuice.
But come on. And this is the dinner scene song. Let's face it.
This defined Beetlejuice, right?
Oh my God.
I mean, come on. Did you ever think that like Batman could also be this?
Now, the thing is everybody owes themselves a trip down memory lane and rewatch Beetlejuice.
I mean, it's a classic.
It's a classic. And the funny part is it still holds up based on what they were doing and how they filmed that movie.
Yeah, I mean, it's all practical effects.
Yeah.
And which is beautiful about that whole thing. And like,
gosh, it's just ridiculous. And it was like they were making a period piece for their period, if that makes sense.
How do you make a period for your period?
What I'm saying is it locked it in to their time frame on purpose.
Yeah.
They weren't trying to be anything but right now.
There's been talk about doing a new Beetlejuice movie, like a sequel, for years, and it's never happened.
You know,
I don't think they should touch it.
They shouldn't touch it unless...
Unless the guy with the shrinking head shows up. And the lady without the legs.
I think Michael Keaton is still well enough at his job and his craft.
He's getting ready to be Batman again.
Shh. We don't know that.
Yes, we do. He's in the trailer already.
We hear him in the trailer.
He's in the trailer. It's like Patrick Stewart's in the recent trailer for Strange.
We're talking about The Flash. Yes.
No,
and
we're
talking about the Flashpoint movie with Batman.
Yeah.
Connected
to Beetlejuice.
Yeah. 7 points to Kevin Bacon.
Yeah.
Because Doctor Strange is meeting X-Men in this new Marvel multiverse movie. And they danced
in
the Marvel movie.
We're talking about
they
Beetlejuice.
They had a dance
off. No, we're on Beetlejuice.
Was based on Footloose, which is 7 points to Kevin Bacon.
Which brings me to my next subject. Don't do crack.
Don't smoke crack.
Next one. Roll up that footage.
Dark as shame, darling. Dark as shame. Thank you for all the joy and pain. Picture show, second balcony. nice we'd meet, second seat, gold Dutch treat, you were sweet.
And of course, this is Jeffrey's favorite movie of all time.
It's not my favorite movie of all time, but Ferris Bueller is one of the greatest movies of all time.
Eh.
But listen, hang on, let's just clarify. I'm gonna be really, really upfront. Jennifer Grey is hot in this movie. And I liked her nose, thank you very much.
Yeah, it's a shame.
I mean, she was hot with the nose.
Yeah.
But I mean, this movie's awesome. This is the song that defined the movie.
Well,
I wanted to move to Chicago after I watched this movie.
You were going to be on parade, right?
Yeah, I mean, I wanted to move to Chicago after watching this movie and be the sausage king of...
Hey, you know, if your dream is to be the sausage king, I mean, how can you go any higher?
Where do you go from there?
All the way down, that's it. But I mean, that being said...
The Ferrari in this movie...
is fantastic.
And they crashed it.
But hey, it's what happens.
I'm telling you, Ferris Bueller was great. And it was so good that Deadpool decided to even use that movie as a playback for the end credit scene.
Yes, he did. Yes, which was great.
It proves how 80s and perfect that movie is.
You're still here. It's over. Go home.
And I owe it all to you.
I've been waiting for so long. Someone to stand by me.
We saw the writing on the wall as we felt this magical fantasy.
Dirty Dancing, okay. Definitely an 80s movie, not based in the 80s. How's that even possible?
Yeah.
But that song, basically, if you hear that song.
There's only a few songs that could go with that movie. That's definitely.
That's the only one. Do you know it? Can you name two movies that go with that song?
Oh, not that song. I'm talking about songs that go with that movie.
Oh, I got you. Yeah. That's for sure.
Yeah.
That song is
that Dirty Dancing.
I mean, nobody puts Baby in a Corner.
Nobody puts Baby in a Corner.
By the way, you know who's in that movie with him? Jennifer Grey, who was hot.
And he liked her nose.
And I liked her nose.
Yeah, I see where that was.
Don't lie. You know she was hot, too.
I don't know.
Oh, my God. The future, this screams that movie. You can't not hear this song and not think back.
Oh, this is nostalgia through and through. I told you guys before, I watched this at the drive-in during the pandemic.
Did you really?
Yeah, they were showing this on the drive-through movie theater, and so we all went. It was awesome.
I haven't seen this in the big screen since 1985.
It was awesome. It's such a throwback. Wow, everybody that's cool, was just actually. Really enjoying it.
I'm kind of jealous now.
It felt great.
I don't remember you calling me and saying, hey, they were going to show this, Jeff. You could go with us and hang out. That's okay. My whiskey's good enough, but the rest of me's not.
We were social distancing.
You're so foolish.
Well, he's fairly intelligent. He's full of shit.
Now, before we talk about this song with this movie, I just want to point out there's somebody on our crew who has never seen this movie up until we talked about
it. Fast fact, that's been changed.
That has now officially been fixed, and the song is...
Stationary. It's like a drum deep in your veins. I will not lose. Will sister.
watch this movie.
Okay, I cannot hear this song.
It makes me excited.
And not think about The Lost Boys.
To watch this movie.
I think, you know, I had a conversation this week, actually, we were talking about this. I was talking to my wife. It's like, I think Zane and I count this as the number one vampire movie of all time.
I have no argument against it.
In Halloween time this year, we're going to have our top five or top 10 vampire movies of all time. This has to be like number one. Talk about them being the best vampires, but this might be the best vampire movie of all time.
Yeah, this is a low budget movie.
Oh, of course it was a low budget movie. You see the saxophone guy?
We almost used that music for this too, because everybody know that one too. But
he would take my shirt off and put a little oil on me.
Yeah.
You know that guy still sings that song, plays that song.
Hell yeah, he does.
That's the only song he's got, but you know.
That's great, actually.
Still an awesome song.
But this movie's great because even though it had a low budget, it still told the story and really took you into it.
It has every trope of a vampire movie, right?
Right.
The coffin's a cave. They can't see the reflection in the mirror, the garlic. Holy water, the garlic thing,
all
the stakes, everything can't be out in the daylight, all those things. But somehow, some way, it was different than everything else.
Right.
I think it was just the fact that the soundtrack was badass.
This is a perfect movie. It's a perfect story. Because it was like the style of the characters, like their costuming. Yeah, people dress like that everywhere.
This was Corey and Corey. This is the epitome of the 80s.
This is the Coreys.
The only other time they've been together in a movie was, what was the other 80s movie? Was Dream a Little Dream?
It's all right. I'm here. I'm with you.
Was Bill in it? No, it was...
Bill? Yeah, Bill was it. Bill and Ted?
Yeah.
He's the first vampire. I went,
yeah, Bill was in it.
Got him in the cave, remember?
Kiefer Sutherland was in it.
Badass vampire.
Protestant preacher from Fifth Avenue's Irregular was in it.
That's right. And then Patrick, what was his name, the main character?
Yeah. Who was being sold to us as a damn high school kid or whatever.
Yeah, but he's acting like a full-grown adult, so he's like 21, I think.
Michael.
Yeah, he's 20-something years old. I mean, he was in Red Dawn.
Which is another
epitome of a great 80s movie, which had Patrick Swayze in it. Maybe it's really Seven Steps to Patrick Swayze, or maybe it's Seven Steps to Jennifer Grey. So what about you? Is there an 80s song that reminds you of an 80s movie that doesn't have the title in it or lyric or lines from the movie that we didn't pick today?
Because I'm pretty sure we've missed a bunch. I know we've already talked about a bunch too.
There was a ton we just kind of cut out that we like, oh, we could do this. I mean, but how many people are going to really want to watch a video of us talking about, I don't know,
700 movies from the 80s.
Exactly. Well, we would.
Yeah, we would.
That's our thing.
That's what we do.
But in the meantime, please sure to like, share, and
subscribe.
And also go visit us on our Facebook group page.
Because where that's where Jeff really engages. Because
Zane loves that group page. And you know what? I think if you talk to him enough, he might actually stop and say something.
We can try.
But in the meantime, you guys continue to be geeky. Check out some more 80s stuff on all our other videos. And be sure to see us on Friday when we review
On Second Pour.
Cheers.